Carl Hyde.
I'm Bob Harris.
Bruce Rickenbach.
David Turner.
Karen McKee.
Mary Lipsett.
Donna Lipsett.
Don Hollister.
Becky Campbell.
Ted Campbell.
John Flivin.
Excellent.
Dave Hale. If you weren't here for the last one, I did just under 30 years at Montgomery County Sheriff's Office. Started as a dispatcher in 1984, worked as a corrections officer, a transportation officer where I took people to hospitals, doctor's offices, prisons. Made deputy, went out to the street, worked a lot of midnights up and down the Dixie Strip, which most people know a little bit about. I worked a couple years out there on midnights with another officer, his name's Phil Plummer, who later becomes sheriff, and our friendship and work relationship probably helped my career a little bit. He not only, I think, is a fairly good sheriff, but he was a very good street cop. A lot of good instincts. Did 5 years of undercover work. Told my wife that she put up with it. At some point, I'd cut my hair and live a normal life. So when the kids got big enough, I got the haircut, went back into uniform, supervised the jail, supervised the dispatch center, went a year of midnight supervising the road patrol, and the sheriff then moved me back to the drug unit, which I oversaw for a couple more years. I got asked to oversee the violent crimes unit, which was the robberies, rapes, homicides, shootings, cuttings. Did that for a couple years, promoted to captain over one of the districts, and was asked to form what is now the Range Task Force there in Montgomery County. Promoted to major, had predominantly oversaw the whole police, the road patrol section of the sheriff's office, and then did my last 18-19 months doing personnel director, hiring, firing contracts, HR, Fair Labor Standards Act, FMLA, a bunch of acronyms. It took me completely out of police work, but probably good experience. So retired there in 84. Figured I'd probably work for UPS or somewhere or something, you know, something that got me out, let me move around a little bit. I didn't have to think too much about. And then I got a call and I was told they needed an interim chief, which I was very, very honored to accept. And that worked into a full-time spot. I've got 20 months or so on now. So October will be 2 years for me. When I started at the sheriff's office in 84, the academy that I went through was 530 hours. It is now 610 hours. There's been a lot of changes, and I think police work in general is under a lot of scrutiny. And right now, from a public opinion standpoint, we look sort of bad. I think the scrutiny is a good thing. I think long-term, that scrutiny is what's gonna make police departments look better and be more professional. Way back, what would happen is, I'd go, well, you're a fine young man, you're doing good in high school, and you're 21 now, why don't you be a cop? Here's a gun, here's a badge, go arrest people. And that's pretty much how it worked. It went from there to, well, I'd give you the gun and the badge, and within a year, you had to get the academy, which was back then like 230 hours, like 6 weeks. And that's, you had a year to get it in. A little on the scary side compared to what we do now. There's now 610 hours. You have to have the academy before you can be a police officer. You have to, the state requires psychological examinations. Police departments do much more thorough background investigations. All those things that may not show it in the news, but is making us more and more of a profession. I started in the days in dispatch where one of the first things they told you in Montgomery County, if our guys get in a pursuit and they're heading over to Indiana, make sure you tell the officers to back away. because fleeing from an officer is a felony. In Indiana, they'd open fire on them. And we did not want our cruisers close enough to catch that. So that's 30-plus years of police work, which right now, America, especially America in their 20s, would be flabbergasted over. But I, again, that's why I believe it is moving and doing the right thing. Because, you know, there's a lot of questions in the news. There's questionable shootings. Police get to use force. That force has to be scrutinized. It has to be examined. But it used to be sort of fair game. Late in 1984-85, a case from the Supreme Court case asked to do with Tennessee versus Garner, where a guy was fleeing. It was a felon. He was fleeing. They shot him in the back. And the Supreme Court said that unless that felon is actually posing a risk of serious physical harm to another person, you can no longer shoot at them. Just because they're a felon, you can't just pop rounds all out. And I think a lot of America doesn't have that perspective. You know, that's where we came from. When I hit the street, there was a lot of professional courtesies. A lot of cops, dog drunk, got taken home even though they were behind the wheel. Domestics were overlooked. And a lot of the cops were get dog drunk, go home, and smack on the spouse. And it was, well, honey, you don't want to do this. You don't want to get him in trouble. Jimmy, just go to bed. And that's how it was handled. The law has changed now, where pretty much the state came out, and there is what's known as a preferred arrest policy. That any time we have signs of domestic violence, there is a physical injury and an allegation, and one witness. You could be the victim and say he didn't do it, but if your daughter sitting there said, yes, he did, he's going to jail. And again, I think when you look at it from the historical perspective, we keep getting more and more professional. Uses of force. I was very young in dispatch, and there was a fairly good guy, and I don't fault him because this was the time, but they had just issued out the PR-24s, which went from a straight baton to this baton that actually had like a T sort of handle on it like this. And he was an ex-Marine, and he stopped down in dispatch and showed everybody. He says, talk to you guys a little bit. I'm going to go use this thing. And sure enough, within an hour, he made a traffic stop and let his supervisor know he had a use of force. I mean, I'm not saying that he didn't have reason to do it, but he probably, what we term, jack the guy up, you know, berate somebody enough that they start standing up to you, and then you thump them a little bit. And unfortunately, that kind of stuff happened. Use of force, the state of Ohio is moving toward it. Most police departments are there. There is a lot of critique of use of force. It has to mean something. You know, there has to be a system in place that you have sort of an outside party. I know when Chief McKee was here in Grody, and everybody loves that, and they're very, very hands-on people, I believe police work is sort of moving away from that, and that chiefs of police, although they should be active in the community and get to know the community, I try really hard not to go on calls unless I'm needed. Because if one of my officers goes out there and has a use of force, I want to be able to be the unattached party to review that force. I don't want to be a partner to it. I don't want to be in the middle of this. I view myself sort of as the CEO of a company. I have sergeants who are those people who are my force supervisors. They are the ones who are supposed to make sure the work gets done, and the patrol officers are the ones to do the work. And I know we're a small department, and I'm happy to go back up a guy. I'll never let a guy go on a call without backup. I will be there, but I try not to get overly involved in the calls. And the other thing we end up with is you start getting into the cameras. In my career, I've seen a proliferation of cameras. in-car cameras, which are activated anytime the overheads come on. The officers have the ability to actually press a button on their belt and activate it. They wear a microphone. And that in itself eliminates a lot of complaints. So people say, well, he said this, or he didn't say that. A lot of times there's that record. I go back, myself and both sergeants arbitrarily, once a month, sit down and review at least 5 videotapes of officers making stuff. No pattern, I'll watch this one. So we have at least 15 reviews per month of our officers. And there's times that we find, okay, you know what? You let the guy get underneath your skin a little more. The terminology you used was maybe not the most professional. But at the same time, there's probably more cases where I go, that officer used great restraint. That person was really sort of trying to get the officer jacked up, and that officer was very professional, polite, approachable, and did the things they did. Every now and then, tactically, we find that we had an officer make a stop one day. The driver had a protection order against him, was not allowed to be in the presence of the passenger of the vehicle. And the guy, 30 times, and I'm not kidding, 30 times says, I'm not going to jail, I can't do it. I'm not going to jail, I can't do it. The officer actually allowed him to sit in the car for about 15 of those times. The guy finally got out, stood there, would not follow their instructions, commands. They finally actually, the two officers lay hand on him, they get him handcuffed, you get him in the car without incident, so everything went really well. But there was also a knife laying underneath the path or the driver's seat of that car. The potential was there, and the guy kept going, I'm not going to jail. I can't take me to jail. Sort of talking himself up into, we gave him time to think, am I going to fight or not? So we suggested some other ways of doing it. Number one, when the two officers start engaging this individual, you still have the passenger who's unattended. They should have called for a third car. That means getting a deputy sheriff from the county here to watch her or something, et cetera. You give the guy 3 or 4 commands, you tell him, this is what we need you to do. And then you say, sir, if you don't get out of the car, I'm gonna put hands on, I'm gonna take you by the shoulder and lead you out of the car. And you talk him through this. You plant things in his head. This is what we're going to do. I'm gonna put my hand on your shoulder and one on your forearm, and I'm gonna help you out of the car here, okay? And then you do those things. So we actually constructed some training for those guys specifically to handle that. Before cameras never would have existed. Use of force, and especially fatalities. And most departments are going to it. The state of Ohio has now mandated it. It needs to be reviewed. It needs to go to a grand jury. We had an allegation against a longtime officer. It was unfounded. I'm very happy it was unfounded, but I called in BCI, which is the Attorney General's predominantly police department, to come in and do that. Some people thought because that officer had been here a long, long time, we should have given him more of a benefit of the doubt. I'm not the guy that believes that. For me to make everyone believe that this is fair, I think we need to be as impartial as we can. I don't think an 11-man police department is very capable of investigating itself when you're looking at things that could result in criminal charges. I am a proponent of calling in an outside agency to do it each and every time. If it's a policy violation, if it's something minor, we'll investigate ourselves, no big deal. But when you start getting to things that truly, truly are criminal, I will call an outside agency in. The prosecutor up to this point has always recused himself and asked for a special prosecutor because most of the prosecutors know these officers and deal with them. And we want impartiality. And if we can't as a police department, stand for what's right, including when one of our own does wrong, then we're really not a police department. So that's sort of my take on it. Again, I know in the media, we take some licks. Some of it's fair. Some of these guys made some really, really poor decisions. Some of them, you know, I'd love to hear a little more background before I make a decision on, but I do believe police work, even with the heat it's taking from a PR standpoint, is moving in the right direction. It's becoming more professional. It's becoming more transparent. And I think that's a good thing for law enforcement in general.
Would you have considered using a bunch of folks from the village to investigate that allegation?
That allegation.
Rather than VCI?
That allegation's criminal. Had to be investigated by a police department.
Couldn't you understand that the village might better have appreciated it if we did it ourselves?
I do. There was a couple things that come into play. Number one, it's an allegation against that officer, and that officer is innocent until proven guilty. So the question becomes is, who do I tell that now that he's being accused of something that he has pretty much been found he did not do? Number two, if a citizens group investigates it, they cannot file charges. So there still has to be a criminal investigation that has to be done by a police department. This was not a policy violation where maybe he fell asleep in a cruiser. The allegation was such that he could have done life in prison. So it had to be investigated by an outside agency.
When you can't win, if you do it the way you did it, then you're a jerk. And if you investigate it, you know, informally, and it turns out to be true, you're covering it up.
There's a lot of no-win situations. You know, police departments are not PR departments. And so, you know, as I said at the very beginning, I'm a sort of wear on my sleeves guy. I sometimes sort of throw it out there and maybe not the most polished approach all the time. I will say the other thing that was happening, that investigation got started, and nobody in the village outside the police department, the village manager and council knew what was going on. The only reason that thing got public was because someone else interjected themselves in it being arrested, and that made the news. That was several weeks after the investigation started. So the whole thing would have stayed very, very quiet, which was my desire until the outcome.
Would you have been in a position to at least acknowledge that life in prison was an option so that we in the village might have understood better why you had to go to BCI? You didn't.
I felt it was known to at least the Yellow Springs News that it was a criminal investigation, but the extent of that criminal investigation was not released. And again, to protect the accused, normally that is not thrown out there. This is, you know, this was not something that happened a week ago. This was something that allegedly happened 15 years ago. I wouldn't rethink it. But originally, like I said, everything got started, BCI got called in, and everything was kept internal and relatively quiet until the outcome of it. And that lasted until the arraignment date. And that was my desire, and that was sort of my focus, to protect that officer, because I really didn't want him to have to go through what happened when it all hit the Yellow Springs news. The Dayton news thing really did not pick it up a ton. They did a little bit, but not much.
I understand, and I think my position at least is that our kids grew up with him, and we've known him for as long as we've lived here, and could not imagine something as serious as that happening.
I understood. And I will tell you, you know, an allegation surfaces, and what I said was, look, allegations are allegations. Until I have a victim who is willing to go on record and make a claim, it's nothing more than rumor. And the allegation was actually known 7 or 8 weeks prior. And there was reasons we waited, but when the time was appropriate, BCI took that person, interviewed her, she went on record, she was audio recorded, I don't think video recorded, and made the allegation. I was not present for that. And when BCI said, this is what she's claiming, I felt there's only one thing to do. If it helps you any, if the allegation was made against me, I would have went to the village manager and said, Ms. Bates, here's what it is, here's the allegation, I can guarantee it did not happen, but you need to put me on administrative leave. I should not be in this department during this time. There has to be that appearance that this is running without any influence from me.
I have a question, Chief, I'm sorry to interrupt, but it's something that maybe you can explain how the BCI investigations work. I was under the impression that the officer wasn't aware of what the charges were.
He was not originally, which is sort of standard criminal investigation. If I believe Kate Hamilton has been forging checks, I'm going to call Kate Hamilton and say, we'd love you to come to the police department. We have a little something we want to talk to you about. We're not going to tell you, we believe you're forging checks. We want you to come to the PD. That allows you to start figuring out alibis, rumors, et cetera. We want you as fresh as possible for that interview. Because then you're going to say things in that interview like, well, that's impossible. I was in Florida during that time. Okay, then we investigate whether or not you're in Florida. Because if you're in Florida, then guess what? That was not you. So we don't want you to get the ability to create what would appear to be an alibi. So he was not given the details of what the criminal charges could be when he was put on administrative leave.
Was there a point when he was given that information?
I'd have to check with BCI. I believe, and I've not read the complete thing, that BCI has been very, very tied up in Piketon, and the officer who did the investigation is there. So I don't have a physical copy of it yet. I believe the victim's allegations fell apart so severely they never interviewed that officer. There was no need to interview that officer. And prior to him being interviewed, he would be informed, this is what we're interviewing about. But Miranda, you have to do that. You have to say, you're being interviewed in regards to the crime of homicide, bad checks, et cetera.
Okay, thanks.
Yes.
As I already said, my name is Bruce Rickenbach. A long time ago, I was village manager and in charge of your police, what was then your police department. I want to know a couple of things. Do you live in the village of Yellow Springs?
I do not.
How many of your officers live in Yellow Springs?
Two.
So they don't really have, and neither do you, have a real sense of what this community is about and what makes it tick. You're just police officers trying to enforce the law without understanding us as a community. This happened some time ago when a then council member had the charter changed very surreptitiously, but it was on the ballot, but none of us knew what it was about. And it got voted in and the charter was changed so that police officers no longer have to live in the village of Yellow Springs. Previously they did. And when they would And most crimes or most things, except for the most egregious that were taken to the Xenia court, went to mayor's court, where they were counseled by the mayor, then counseled by the police officer, and periodically, as they drove around the community, would see that person, call him over to the car, and talk to him again about what they had done and whether their behavior had changed. That doesn't seem to be going on anymore. What seems to be happening is that for the majority of tickets or whatnot are written under state law, they're shipped off to the Xenia County Jail, where they get no counseling, and they're very angry. When they get out, they come back to the community, and they repeat behavior, and they repeat the behavior. What is it that you can do about that? We were told by your village manager that you lived in, that she had had a conversation with you and the village mayor, and had come to an agreement that most things would be charged under village ordinance rather than under state law, so that it could go to mayor's court. But what I understand is that most citations are cited under state law and they go to Xenia for court. That's what I understand.
I believe you're incorrect.
Okay, if I'm incorrect, please correct me and tell me how it works.
Okay, what I've done, and although I did not bring it with me, I have been breaking down statistically where they fall. And the majority of them are still going to mayor's court. There is a couple issues that we have discussed, and that is what the new task force, Kate, the restorative justice task force, whatever they termed it, and they want to address. One of the issues that you have is that there's a question as to whether or not a mayor can reduce a charge. And I am not an attorney, so I please don't block me on everything. But my belief is that the mayor or judge is the decider of fact. They define you guilty or not guilty. One of the problems we have is DUIs were going in front of the mayor, and they were saying, well, we're going to make this a reckless op. That is not the mayor's job. It is not his description. You need a prosecutor to do that. They do not have a prosecutor. I suggest strongly that if the village wants to continue mayor's court, they need a prosecutor. Another issue would be that if an individual goes in front of mayor's court and the mayor orders him incarcerated, the incarceration of that individual is then the bill of the village. At this point, there's no money in the budget to do that. That has to be addressed also. The law is such that there are certain crimes that cannot go in front of mayor's court, and the one which is probably the most contentious, and it can go in front of mayor's court, is DUIs. The problem is if a person gets convicted in mayor's court of a DUI, there is an enhancement that if you get so many of these, it becomes a felony. That conviction in mayor's court, per prosecutor Steve Howler, Greene County prosecutor, he cannot use. There's also certain things that if you're looking at jail time, you have to be given an attorney. You cannot represent yourself. That bill becomes the village's also. So for them to do this, and I believe it is the village's decision out in mayor's court, it's not mine. I try my best not to weigh in on such things. My job is to come in and run the police department. The village wants the mayor's court, I'm all for mayor's court. They brought me into the drug task force case. I gave my opinion. I lost. It's the village's decision. I don't have a problem with that. So I believe that is what the village gets to decide. It's in their thing. But to do it there's got to be a financial commitment, and that is not in the budget yet, and it's something they're going to have to deal with.
Well, out of all of the cases that you arrest, whatever you want to call them, that you'd have to deal with, how many fit within this category that you're talking about?
I have to look at...
50%?
I can tell you that outside of DUIs, the bulk of the tickets, again, almost every, and I've not told the officer they can't send an OBI to mayor's court. Have not told them that. I think it's a perfect thing that, and I'm sure you're like 37 or something, but if you've lived in this village 20 years, you have no problem, you're not a problem, you have that third glass of wine one day with dinner, and somebody pulls you over, and they feel that they have to cite you, I think that's an excellent case to take to mayor's court. Okay, they have the ability to do that. We had a recent situation where there's a couple. The male portion of this couple is under suspension. The female, the car, the registration expired. There was two verbal warnings given for the registration being expired. The male was seen one day at a gas station getting out of the car. The officer walked over to him and said, look, I know you don't have driving privileges. You shouldn't be driving that car. I'm not going to go across the street and sit on you, but I don't want to see you drive anymore. In late November, early December, they catch the person, their license or the registration still expired. They give them a ticket. Well, 3 days ago, they run the plate because that person paid for their license. But because it was over 90 days, it still expired on the person's birthday. And guess what? They didn't renew their license. So they got another ticket. This one went to mayor, or to Xenia. They had been warned. The first ticket went to mayor's court. The second ticket went to Xenia. I see those things, a lot of the speeding tickets, a lot of the crashes, a lot of the more reckless behavior. The officers usually will look at their driving record and make that determination, because if you have no real driving record and you got out and you were going a little fast one day, it's probably not that big of a deal. They tend to go to mayor's court. But if your driving record is poor or you've been warned and you're not learning, the officers believe there's a possibility of jail time, and they go to Xenia. And that is sort of the defining line as to where those tickets go.
I'm just wondering what the percentage is. It sometimes could feel like it's all of them, but I'm sure that's not the case.
Yeah. I have it. It'll be presented out of the, it may be skewed a little bit too, because there's a lot of parking tickets there. The too far from the curb, wrong way side of the street, those are all cited under village ordinances and all go to mayor's court. Yeah. So there's a large percentage that actually goes to mayor's court. When you start getting into the moving violations and the reckless violations, I would say a large percent of them go to Xenia. But usually, again, one of the things, they're driving under suspension, and especially if they've done it two or three times, they're looking at jail time. And they do not get incarcerated through mayor's court. There's no budget for it to do that. So, and I'm not opposed to doing that, but there's got to be a budget for it.
One thing I noticed that, in spite of the fact that the drug task force issue was defeated, unfortunately, but nonetheless, you guys do seem to be doing a really good job in trying to eradicate the village of a lot of this drug traffic. That's a huge concern of mine, and I for one, really appreciate that work effort. Can you give us a sense of, without the drug task force, with your individuals, how's that working for you guys?
I think most citizens on a day-to-day basis will not see a big difference.
Okay.
My concern is with drugs, there's money, and with money and the desire to obtain money, there comes violence. If you're coming from Huber Heights and you're going to deliver drugs out to you to somewhere in Greene County, and you want to meet this guy from Xenia, are you going to tell him to meet you in Beaver Creek where the task force works, or meet you in Yellow Springs where the task force doesn't work. I think one of the great things we have going for us is we have a fairly good uniform presence. Because we're 1.9 miles, you know, the likelihood of them seeing a cruiser is a very big deterrent. And, you know, I don't know that I could ever say that if you stayed in the task force, you're never going to have a violent drug-related crime. You can't do that. You know, the one of the concerns is, from a patrol standpoint, if I'm going out there and being proactive for drugs, I am in fact probably getting the person who is possessing and using drugs 98 and 99% of the time, as opposed to the task force who attempts to focus on the guys selling the drugs. Although it is illegal to use drugs and those laws have to be enforced too, I do understand that an addict needs help. Incarceration does not help an addict. I'm not even sure incarceration helps a thief. I mean, you could argue that.
It depends on what he gets when he's in there. There are treatment programs.
Absolutely.
It was announced on the news yesterday that Dayton was the worst city in the nation for drugs.
For heroin. Heroin. Overdoses,
what,
yes.
What's the heroin situation in the village? Is it serious?
Mm-hmm. I think much like anywhere else, there are cultures and subcultures of people who want to party and are willing to use these things. It's here. There are a large majority of people who don't seek it out, don't do that, are not influenced by it until a nephew, a grandson, a grandniece becomes involved. And I think most of us probably have that family member or family friend who knows somebody who has been affected by it. But, you know, you can live your life and never, ever see it. I mean, it's not like it is any more rampant here. And I see his face, and I'm not coming up with his name, runs TCSN, and he even said, look, it's per capita, Yellow Springs has about the same problem as Xenia or Beaver Creek or Fairborn. You know, we're a lot less people. He's seen pretty dominantly the same ratio per capita of it. So it is here. It, you know, there's nothing wrong with establishments that sell beer and liquor. But, you know, there is that sort of bar crowd. And if you're into that bar crowd and that partying crowd, a section of that culture is willing to step it up to the next thing, be it cocaine, be it heroin, et cetera. And it's here. I mean, it's around. You know, I believe I've had a couple people. I interviewed a girl very early on when I got here, was on a stolen car, and I asked the officer if I could go with him, Xenia jail, and interview. And he got done with his interview on the stolen car, and I said, do you mind? You've been pretty honest. I'm not going to ask for names. I'm not looking to jam you up or charge you with anything. But I said, how bad's heroin in Yellow Springs? And she said, oh, it's bad. I said, you can get it anytime you wanted it? Yeah. So what's the youngest person you've seen use heroin? She said, 13. So it is there. I mean, I don't say that to scare you, because again, there, you know, 90%+ of people, it's something over there, and it goes on and does not affect the lives of people unless somebody steals, you know, something out of your car to trade for heroin. That's where you become affected by it most of the time.
Well, several years ago, how long ago was it when we had the robberies in our neighborhood?
I think it's 2 years.
Was it what?
I think it was like 2 years ago.
Yeah.
Or maybe a little bit longer, but that was
the connected. I think the chief was here.
It was prior to me coming in. There was a couple that was living together that burglarized a lot of places.
Oh, yeah. No, after that, though. There was someone attempting.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then they were found. They stole cars and stuff, and they were found to have some sort of heroin issue, I believe.
Often, well, and that's sort of always been my point, is, you know, to some degree, and I don't mean to be impassionate, but if someone chooses to put something in their veins, Okay. You know, I could almost argue that you should have the right to do that. But my concern as a police officer, when that person becomes an addict, and because of that addiction, steals from the neighbor, steals from someone else. There is a resident in town and allowed someone to stay with her, and I understand the situation, but I can show where that individual broke into one of her neighbors and stole the television. And we have the TV. We know that he pawned the TV. He was stopped several times with heroin. And I talked to her about it, and I said, look, my concern is at some point, if he becomes desperate enough, he hurts you. And if he doesn't hurt you, that he brings someone else who uses over, who is a far more desperate, far more violent individual, and he hurts you. Because, Tony, you make a really great victim. I mean, as we age and we're not as physically imposing and as agile as we used to be, we become better victims. And that is my concern.
Do your guys carry Narcan?
Yes.
I was just about to give him props for that, because
very early on,
the chief really pursued getting it on board.
Yes.
Drugs aside, what do we do about drunken drivers? I think it's a very serious problem. They all probably drink a little bit. That's one thing. It's another thing to get bombed and go out and drive up the wrong way in interstate and kill people. And furthermore, when you have three or four convictions against you, you're still driving.
Yes.
Now, that's entirely in my book. You throw them in jail and throw the key away. Now, justice says you can't deprive a man of getting a living wage. Well, wait a minute. How about these guys? I have no tolerance for someone that gets bombed and goes out and kills somebody, and there seems to be enough of this to be concerned about it. I don't know what you can do, because all you can do is arrest him. You go to a judge and you got some fancy lawyer that gets him off scot-free, and he's out on the street after 8 or 9 charges. Now, come on.
It is a problem. It's a problem for America. For the village itself, since I've been here, we've not had an injury crash relating to an OVI, which, you know, knock on wood, that's all good. The officers are out there. They make a lot of stops. Sometimes that, you know, people feel like they make too many stops. But they're out there. I don't want to say they're aggressively looking, but they are aware. If they see the indicators, they'll try to make the traffic stop and take the OVI. So we've charged, we get 4 or 5 a month, which may not seem like much, but when you look at the square area, that's actually a pretty good statistic. The law is in place where it is stepped up. I don't know what the answer is. I really don't know long term. And it's much like with drugs, you're never going to wipe the problem out. Law enforcement, I try to tell the young guys, if you think you're here being a hero and saving lives, you will be an unhappy police officer. What you have to realize is, to some degree, we're here to do our job and hopefully maintain the status quo and try to keep people as safe as possible by doing that. I mean, we may move the status quo a little bit, which I guess doesn't make it the status quo technically, but the baseline may be the better point. Because no matter what we do as law enforcement, I can't stop you from having 6 beers and getting in a wheel. So you're there as that deterrence. You're there as the, if you don't come home on time, then you're grounded or you're spanked or you're sent to your room, or you lose driving privileges. That's what law enforcement sort of represents, is the disciplinarian parental side for a lot of these people. And all we can do is maintain that line and continue it. And to do that, if your officers are willing to do that, tell them all the time, you can't worry about what the prosecutors do. I'm willing to fight the prosecutors to some degree, but I'm going to lose. The prosecutor says, no, this charge isn't applicable. I'm willing to argue with them up to a point. I'm not willing to you know, cut off my nose to spite my face for it. But my job is to argue a little bit. I'm supposed to go out, you know, a little bit on the fringe and do what I can, but I'm not going to hurt myself so bad that the next time they won't listen to me at all. And you sort of have to maintain that as an officer to keep some degree of mental toughness long term, because if not, you tend to burn out a little bit.
I didn't think it was much of a problem, really, in Yellow Springs, but I'm thinking what the state police have to put up with.
It is amazing. You know, it's a lot of them are that third or fourth drink. You know, they're not exactly hammered, but you see the ones that are, and it's horrific. And you know, one of the things that comes with this camera of society is we see so much more of it. And the news loves to put it on. People love watching it. I'm a cop. I like watching it. But it bends our thinking, because since the inception of the automobile, I guarantee you within a couple of weeks, there was somebody who drank a six-pack and got behind the wheel and drove that Model T. And it probably didn't go fast enough to hurt somebody that bad, and you didn't have all the congestion and the volume. But it's, you know, it's probably happened since the inception of the automobile.
I've heard that the police officers will give people rides home and things like that. I mean, you're not a taxi service, obviously. I think that it could also be, it's a community responsibility in a way, when you see that someone has had too much to drink. And I've given rides home to people that I don't even really know that well. And people have given me rides, or you know, Yellow Springs is small, you can stumble home.
Yeah, it's true.
Kind of, but yeah. You know, it's dangerous even to ride your bike when you're under the influence. You probably won't take anyone else out with you, but
I push the officer. You know, and if I offend, I apologize. But we term it chicken shit in police work. I don't want that. If you're driving down the road and you're going past Peaches, and here's somebody getting his keys out and he's stumbling, you don't go across the street and wait for him to get in the car. You pull in that parking lot and you tell him, "Sir, if you're thinking of getting behind that wheel, you're probably going to go to jail. I strongly suggest you go inside, you call a cab. If you know somebody here in town, call them. If you live close, let me pat you down, make sure you don't have a gun that I'm going to put behind my head, and I'll run you home." And we do that. You know, it's not all about taking people to jail. I do believe there's a point, and judges get to decide that more than cops, thank God, because I don't want the responsibility on me. But when you make the errors enough that nothing else is working, that incarceration is the appropriate route. You know, I try to let our guys know that's not a cop's decision. That's not what we do. We go out on most of these things and collect fact, collect witness statements, collect evidence, and present that. That's our job. And, you know, we're not the ones who decide that I don't like this person, and so every time I see him, they're going to go to jail. That's bad police work. That's not what we do. We should start every day with a clean slate, with as little bias as our human minds will allow us to have, and treat everybody equally and fairly. And that's what I try to push.
Chief, early on you were talking about somebody who you said he didn't want to go to jail and sat in the car for, said it 15 or 20 times. And I just want to make sure I understand. Was your position that they shouldn't have waited so long, or it's fine to wait until he calms down as opposed to shooting him?
Yeah. Well, it wouldn't have come to a shooting scenario, but they probably let him sit in that car longer than they should. I would have liked to have seen him went hands-on on a soft approach. Again, you know, sir, listen, it's a temporary protection order against the person sitting here. If we don't arrest, we're in violation of a judge's order, because it is a judge's order. We can't be in violation of, so we have no choice. It is an arrestable, mandatory arrest. You know, you got to come to the car with us. You know, you just putting your hands on somebody is sort of that authority thing. So as he's seated, you know, number one, I'm behind him.
Yeah.
So if he's got anything in his hands or his hands move, I'm going to see it. Number two, psychologically, I take a position of authority over this guy.
Yeah.
Sir, I know you don't want to go to jail, but we need to get you up. it's going to happen. You need to walk to my car. I'm going to put my hand on your forearm, one up underneath your arm. I'm going to help you out of the car here with me, okay?
But I'm innocent. I didn't know anything.
So, protection order, and it's all good. Yeah. Well, I mean, and we have those debates.
I'm innocent.
Oh, absolutely. He knew he wasn't innocent. He knew the protection order was there. She wanted to drop the protection order, but hadn't yet. And she's dropped it, different story. But he's in violation of it because it's still physically there.
I have another question. Are there any black police officers in Yellow Springs now?
No, we do not have any. We tested last September. I ended up testing 36, five of which were minority. So you end up with almost that 13-16% area. Out of that test, we've hired one. And we took the top 15 scores, put them through a physical agility test, everyone passed. And then we took the top five of those and did backgrounds on them. Out of those, we actually only hired one. Two were female, one we hired, this Mr. John Whittemore, prior experience, and he was at Jamestown, and the other two were white males.
Has there been any discussion or feelings that maybe it would help in a small town like this if you had more minority police officers?
You will not have to convince me in the least. I'd love to. I will tell you, and I read an article in the Dayton Daily News a year ago, I think Dayton had spent $1.2 million trying to get more minority recruits, and it was ineffective. I don't know the answer to it. I think some of it is sort of a cultural thing. I know a lot of young black parents are telling me that they believe that anytime their child is in contact with a law enforcement officer, they're in fear of that child's life. It's going to be a very hard environment when that mentality exists to get those young men to come in. I know part of that article also definitely interviewed one of the guys, and he's like, you know, I sort of think about it. Man, I don't know what my friends would say. So there, police departments all over the nation understand this. We believe we need to be responsive to our community. We need to be representative of our community. They struggle to get it, but it just, there often is not the interest in the young minority community to get there.
And what about working with the schools? I mean, when kids are growing up, you know, you see them, you know their parents, you know they're part of the community. It seems like that would be a perfect place to start recruiting when they're in junior high school.
It is. You know, one of the things that you run into, and it's a well-meaning federal plan, but effectively you have to ever accept any federal grant, which the village does, you have to be an equal employment opportunity employer. And that requires that you have a standardized test and that you take the top three, the top five, you test them through, and you consider, even though the test scores may be 2 or 3 points different, you have to consider that as a one test score. And so when you do these things, you end up there. And if you have a black candidate in the top five, they're very happy. Providing he passes everything else, absolutely. Because I do believe it's representative of Yellow Springs would love it. And I should be responsive to this community to the best of my ability. This time we did not get one of those candidates. I thought we had one black female, five black males, and I think a Hispanic person or two. At least two of the black males of military background, which is often, you know, because of the military and police work being sort of paramilitary, there's sort of a draw. And you know, we will test again September when our list expires. We'll keep it active for a year. We will test again, go through the whole process again. that those are the requirements to be an equal opportunity employer, you have to go through those steps.
I'm sorry, but with all due respect, you didn't answer his basic question.
Okay, I apologize.
Why aren't you going into the local schools and talking to our students about the possibility of becoming a police officer, including the black kids in our schools? And I didn't hear you say anything about that.
I will tell you, every time I have been invited by a school to do anything, I have been there. I was at sixth grade graduation yesterday. I have spoke to the young people of color. John Guzzles invited me to two or three things. I have been there each and every time. Have I supplanted myself and went to the superintendent and said, I want to come talk to these kids about being cops? No, I have not. They did ask me to come and speak before a prom about OBIs and the danger of OBIs. I did that. And maybe it's me. Maybe I should be more aggressive in this area, but it seems to me it is the schools. If the schools want me in, I'll come in and talk about anything. I've been in churches and spoke. Early on, when the Black Lives Matter group was coming in, I was the only speaker who sort of had an opposing viewpoint. I was there. I was here 6 weeks, 8 weeks. Took a little bit of something. My village manager was like, are you sure you want to do this? And I'm like, it's an opinion. I'm going to issue an opinion. I hopefully will be there. I'm happy to do it. I just don't know that it's my role to interject myself into the schools. I'm willing to do it.
Have you been disinvited?
Not that I'm aware of.
You know what, Bruce, I would say...
Let me finish.
All right, there was a question.
When Jim McKee, your longtime predecessor, mm-hmm. was police chief, he would make it a weekly habit to go into each school in the system, walk the hallways, walk into classrooms. The teachers would always introduce him and who he was. Okay. And he would get an opportunity to talk to both white kids and black kids about becoming police officers. And I don't get the sense that that's what you're doing.
I
don't think that you would be disinvited. I think that they would more than invite your presence in their school buildings to talk to their students about police work, about becoming police officers, and so on. But I don't hear you saying anything about doing that.
I will tell you, I spoke to Mr. Cryer, Mr. Hausch, and Mr. Basoro, and said, anytime you need something from me, you want me there, you let me know. Again, have I been aggressive enough to implant myself? No. And maybe I should consider that. I have not been a police chief before. This is sort of new territory for me. I will consider the idea. On a personal, I'm probably not that brash, but I'm not opposed to doing it. It seems to me, and Pastor Randolph's invited me to the church, I've taken those opportunities. Much like I said, what do you want me to speak about? And I sort of give them that. And maybe historically it's been that way. You may very well be right, and maybe I need to be better at it.
Maybe what is needed is, I think, more than just sort of presence, because I don't think that's enough, not just in this case, but in all cases, similar cases, similar communities. I think maybe if somehow you could work with the school system in terms of working out some type of program, and I'm not in a position to say what that program should be, but something that does more than just talk about or try to recruit it, but somehow establishing a program that sort of emphasizes the necessity, the opportunities, etc. And that's something that not just this community, but in general, I don't think it's being done. And I think that would go a long ways towards helping to solve this problem.
I think the point that these guys, excuse me, the point that these guys are trying to make is that there was a rapport, an incredibly good, wonderful rapport between the whole police department and the village, and especially the kids growing up. And what they're wondering is, could you be involved? Could you see the future, the need, the advantage of such an approach, and actually do it?
Yes. And I guess here's one of my things. One of the issues I came when I came here, I have, out of my 10 full-time officers, me being one of them, five of them had less than a year on. One of the things is, it is not the world when Chief McKee was here. You could take that guy, that high school guy, and go, you know, you're doing a good job. Why don't you come be a cop? When I spoke to the high school kids before prom, and one of the things I did is I had all sorts of job titles and average salaries. And we went over, okay, this is what you're going to pay for housing, and this is what you're going to pay for groceries. And they had sheets of paper. They were making $85,000, eight and a half sheets of paper. So I cut off this much for housing, et cetera. And then I said, what's an OBI going to cost you? Because it's about $10,000. And I cut that off, and they went, oh. Well, one of the things I asked, I said, anybody here want to be a cop or a fireman? I got zero response. Which doesn't mean that there wasn't anybody there. I am willing to do this, and again, maybe I need to be better at it. I've been very open with Mr. Gudgel. I'm willing to come in. I'm willing to talk.
Well, I think the difference between what these guys have been saying and what you're saying is the difference between doing it and being willing to do it.
I'm not quite sure you got what I was trying to get at.
Yeah.
It's not just a matter of saying something and talking about it. It's, I was talking about establishing some type of program, which is quite different from what's been said.
Pretty much, the state came out, and there's what's known as a preferred arrest policy, that any time we have signs of domestic violence, there is a physical injury and an allegation, and one witness. You could be the victim and say, he didn't do it, but if your daughter sitting there said, yes, he did, he's going to jail. And again, I think when you look at it from the historical perspective, we keep getting more and more professional. Uses of force. I was very young in dispatch, and there was a fairly good guy, and I don't fault him because this was the time, but they had just issued out the PR-24s, which went from a straight baton to this baton that actually had like a T, so a handle on it like this. And he was an ex-Marine, and he stopped down in dispatch and showed everybody. He says, talk to you guys a little bit, I'm going to go use this thing. And sure enough, within an hour, he made a traffic stop and let his supervisor know he had to use the force. I mean, I'm not saying that he didn't have reason to do it, but he probably, what we term, jacked the guy up, you know, berate somebody enough that they start standing up to you, and then you thump them a little bit. And unfortunately, that kind of stuff happened. Use of force, stabilized, moving toward it, and most police departments are there. There is a lot of critique of use of force. It has to mean something. You know, there has to be a system in place that you have sort of an outside party. I know when Chief McKee was here and Grody, and everybody loves that, and they're very, very hands-on people, I believe police work is sort of moving away from that, and that chiefs of police, although they should be active in the community and get to know the community, I try really hard not to go on calls unless I'm needed. Because if one of my officers goes out there and has a use of force, I want to be able to be the unattached party to review that force. I don't want to be a partner to it. I don't want to be in the middle of this. I view myself sort of as the CEO of a company. I have sergeants who are those people who are my four supervisors, they are the ones who are supposed to make sure the work gets done, and the patrol officers are the ones to do the work. And I know we're a small department, and I'm happy to go back up a guy. I'll never let a guy go on a call without backup. I will be there, but I try not to get overly involved in the calls. And the other thing we end up with is you start getting into the whole, the cameras, micro-upping the proliferation of cameras, in-car cameras, which are activated anytime the overheads come on. The officers have the ability to actually press a button on their belt and activate it. They wear a microphone. And that in itself eliminates a lot of complaints. If people say, well, he said this or he didn't say that. A lot of times there's that record. I go back, myself and both sergeants arbitrarily once a month sit down and review at least 5 videotapes of officers making stuff. No pattern, I'll watch this one. So we have at least 15 reviews per month of our officers, and there's times that we find, okay, you know what? You let the guy get underneath your skin a little more. The terminology you used was maybe not the most professional. But at the same time, there's probably more cases where I go, that officer used great restraint. That person was really sort of trying to get the officer jacked up, and that officer was very professional, polite, approachable, and did the things they did. Every now and then, tactically, we find that we have an officer make a stop one day. The driver had a protection order against him, was not allowed to be in the presence of the passenger of the vehicle. And the guy, 30 times, and I'm not kidding, 30 times says, I'm not going to jail, I can't do it. I'm not going to jail, I can't do it. The officer actually allowed him to sit in the car for about 15 of those times. The guy finally got out, stood there, would not follow their instructions, commands. They finally actually, the two officers lay hand on him, they get him handcuffed, you get him in the car without incident, so everything went really well. But there was also a knife laying underneath the path, or the driver's seat of that car. The potential was there, and the guy kept going, I'm not going to jail. I can't. Like, he can't take me to jail. He's sort of talking himself up into, we gave him time to think, am I going to fight or not? So we suggested some other ways of doing it. Number one, when the two officers start engaging this individual, you still have the passenger who's unattended. They should have called for a third car. That means getting a deputy sheriff from the county here to watch her or something, etc. You give the guy 3 or 4 commands, you tell him, this is what we need you to do. And then you say, sir, if you don't get out of the car, I'm gonna put hands on, I'm gonna take you by the shoulder and lead you out of the car. And you talk him through this. You plant things in his head. This is what we're going to do. I'm gonna put my hand on your shoulder, one on your forearm, and I'm gonna help you out of the car here, okay? And then you do those things. So we actually constructed some training for those guys specifically to handle that. Before cameras, never would have existed. Use of force, and especially fatalities. And most departments are going to it. The state of Ohio has now mandated it. It needs to be reviewed. It needs to go to a grand jury. We had an allegation against a longtime officer. It was unfounded. I'm very happy it was unfounded. But I called in BCI, which is the Attorney General's predominantly police department, to come in and do that. Some people thought because that officer had been here a long, long time, we should have given him more of a benefit of the doubt. I'm not the guy that believes that. For me, to make everyone believe that this is fair, I think we need to be as impartial as we can. I don't think an 11-man police department is very capable of investigating itself when you're looking at things that could result in criminal charges. I am a proponent of calling in an outside agency to do it each and every time. You know, if it's a policy violation, if it's something minor, we'll investigate ourselves, no big deal. But when you start getting into things that truly, truly are criminal, I will call an outside agency in. The prosecutor up to this point has always recused himself and asked for a special prosecutor, because most of the prosecutors know these officers and deal with them. And we want impartiality. And, you know, if we can't, as a police department, stand for what's right, including when one of our own does wrong, then we're really not a police department. So that's sort of my take on it. Again, I know in the media we take some licks. Some of it's fair. Some of these guys made some really, really poor decisions. Some of them, you know, I'd love to hear a little more background before I make a decision on, but I do believe police work, even with the heat it's taking from a PR standpoint, is moving in the right direction, is becoming more professional, is becoming more transparent, and I think that's a good thing for law enforcement in general.
Would you have considered using a bunch of folks from the village to investigate that allegation?
That allegation's criminal, had to be investigated by a police department.
Couldn't you understand the village might better have appreciated it if we did it ourselves?
I do. There was a couple things that come into play. Number one, it's an allegation against that officer, and that officer is innocent until proven guilty. So the question becomes is, who do I tell that now that he's being accused of something that he has pretty much been found that he did not do? Number two, if a citizens group investigates it, they cannot file charges. So they still has to be a criminal investigation that has to be done by a police department. This was not a policy violation where maybe he fell asleep in a cruiser. The allegation was such that he could have done life in prison. So it had to be investigated by an outside agency.
Well, you can't win. If you do it the way you did it, then you're a jerk. And if you investigate it, you know, informally and it turns out to be true, you're covering it up.
There's a lot of no-win situations. You know, police departments are not PR departments. And so, you know, as I said at the very beginning, I'm a sort of wear-it-on-my-sleeves guy, and I sometimes sort of throw it out there and maybe not the most polished approach all the time. I will say the other thing that was happening, that investigation got started, and nobody in the village outside the police department, the village manager and council knew what was going on. The only reason that thing got public was because someone else interjected themselves and ended up being arrested, and that made the news. That was several weeks after the investigation started. So the whole thing would have stayed very, very quiet, which was my desire until the outcome.
Would you have been in a position to at least acknowledge that life in prison was an option, so that we, the village, might have understood better why you had to go to DCI? You didn't.
I felt it was known to at least the Yellow Springs News that it was a criminal investigation, but the extent of that criminal investigation was not released. And again, to protect the accused, normally that is not thrown out there. This is, you know, this was not something that happened a week ago. This was something that allegedly happened 15 years ago. And maybe, I'm not saying I wouldn't rethink it. But originally, like I said, everything got started, BCI got called in, and everything was kept internal and relatively quiet until the outcome of it. And that lasted for until the arraignment date. And that was my desire, and that was sort of my focus, to protect that officer, because I really didn't want him to have to go through what what happened when it all hit the, you know, the, at least the Yellow Springs news, the Dayton news thing really did not pick it up a ton. They did a little bit, but not much.
I understand, and I think my position at least is that our kids grew up with him. And we've known him for as long as we've lived here and could not imagine something as serious as that happening.
Understood. And I will tell you, you know, an allegation surfaces. And what I said was, look, allegations are allegations. Until I have a victim who is willing to go on record and make a claim, it's nothing more than rumor. And the allegation was actually known 7 or 8 weeks prior. And there was reasons we waited, but when the time was appropriate, BCI took that person, interviewed her, she went on record, she was audio recorded, I don't think video recorded, and made the allegation. I was not present for that. And when BCI said, this is what she's claiming, I felt there's only one thing to do. If it helps you any, if the allegation was made against me, I would have went to the village manager and said, Miss Bates, here's what it is, here's the allegation. I can guarantee it did not happen, but you need to put me on administrative leave. I should not be in this department during this time. And there has to be that appearance that this is running without any influence from me.
I have a question, Chief. I'm sorry to interrupt.
No problem.
It's something that maybe you can explain how the BCI investigations work. I was under the impression that the officer wasn't aware of what the charges were.
He was not originally, which is sort of standard criminal investigation. If I believe Kate Hamilton has been forging checks, I'm going to call Kate Hamilton and say, we'd love you to come to the police department. We have a little something we want to talk to you about. We're not going to tell you, we believe you're forging checks. We want you to come to the PD. That allows you to start figuring out alibis, rumors, etc. We want you as fresh as possible for that interview. Because you're going to say things in that interview like, well, that's impossible. I was in Florida during that time. Okay. And we investigate whether or not you're in Florida. Because if you're in Florida, then guess what? That was not you. So we don't want you to get the ability to create what would appear to be an alibi. So he was not given the details of what the criminal charges could be when he was put on administrative leave.
Was there a point when he was given that information?
I'd have to check with BCI. I believe, and I've not read the complete thing, but BCI has been very, very tied up in Piketon, and the officer who did the investigation is there. So I don't have a physical copy of it yet. I believe the victim's allegations fell apart so severely, they never interviewed that officer. There was no need to interview that officer. And prior to him being interviewed, he would be informed, this is what we're interviewing about. But Miranda, you have to do that. You have to say you're being interviewed in regards to the crime of homicide, bad checks, etc. Yes, sir.
As I already said, my name is Bruce Rickenbach. A long time ago, I was village manager and in charge of your police, what was then your police department. I want to know a couple of things. Do you live in the village of Yellow Springs?
I do not.
How many of your officers live in Yellow Springs?
Two.
So they don't really, and neither do you, have a real sense of what this community is about and what makes it tick. You're just police officers trying to enforce the law without understanding us as a community. This happened some time ago when a then council member had the charter changed very surreptitiously, but it was on the ballot, but none of us knew what it was about. And it got voted in and the charter was changed so that police officers no longer have to live in the village of Yellow Springs. Previously they did. And when they would and most crimes or most things, except for the most egregious that were taken to the senior court, went to mayor's court, where they were counseled by the mayor, then counseled by the police officer, and periodically, as they drove around the community, would see that person, call them over to the car, and talk to them again about what they had done and whether their behavior had changed. That doesn't seem to be going on anymore. What seems to be happening is that for the majority of tickets or whatnot are written under state law, they're shipped off to the Xenia County Jail where they get no counseling, and they're very angry. When they get out, they come back to the community and they repeat behavior, and they repeat the behavior. What is it that you can do about that? We were told by your village manager that you lived in, that she had had a conversation with you and the village mayor, and that had come to an agreement that most things would be charged under village ordinance rather than under state law, so that it could go over to mayor's court. But what I understand is that most citations are cited under state law and they go to Xenia for court. That's what I understand.
I believe you're incorrect.
Okay, I'm incorrect, please correct me and tell me how it works.
Okay, what I've done, and although I did not bring it with me, I have been breaking down statistically where they fall. And the majority of them are still going to mayor's court. There is a couple issues that we have discussed, and that is what the new task force, okay, the restorative justice task force, whatever they've termed it, and they want to address. One of the issues that you have is that there is a question as to whether or not a mayor can reduce a charge. And I'm not an attorney, so I please don't block me on everything, but my belief is that the mayor or judge is the decider of fact. They either find you guilty or not guilty. One of the problems we have is DUIs were going in front of the mayor, and they were saying, well, we're going to make this a reckless op. That is not the mayor's job. It is not his description. You need a prosecutor to do that. They do not have a prosecutor. I suggest strongly that if the village wants to continue mayor's court, they need a prosecutor. Another issue would be that if an individual goes in front of mayor's court and the mayor orders him incarcerated, the incarceration of that individual is then the bill of the village. At this point, there's no money in the budget to do that. That has to be addressed also. The law is such that there are certain crimes that cannot go in front of mayor's court, and the one which is probably the most contentious, and it can go in front of mayor's court, is DUIs. The problem is if a person gets convicted in mayor's court of a DUI, there is an enhancement that if you get so many of these, it becomes a felony. That conviction in mayor's court, per prosecutor Steve Howler, Greene County prosecutor, he cannot use. There's also certain things that if you're looking at jail time, you have to be given an attorney. You cannot represent yourself. That bill becomes the village's also. So for them to do this, and I believe it is the village's decision out in mayor's court, it's not mine. I'm try my best not to weigh in on such things. My job is to come in and run the police department. The village wants the mayor's court, I'm all for mayor's court. They brought me into the drug task force case, I gave my opinion, I lost. It's the village's decision. I don't have a problem with that. So I believe that is what the village gets to decide, it's in their thing. But to do it, there's got to be a financial commitment, and that is not in the budget yet, and it's something they're going to have to deal with.
Well, out of all of the cases that you arrest, whatever you want to call them, that you'd have to deal with, how many fit within this category that you're talking about?
I'd have to look at...
50%?
I can tell you that outside of DUIs, the bulk of the tickets, again, almost every, and I've not told the officer they can't send an OVI to mayor's court. Have not told them that. I think it's a perfect thing that, I'm sure you're what, 37 or something, but if you've lived in this village 20 years, you have no problem, you're not a problem, you have that third glass of wine one day with dinner, and somebody pulls you over, and they feel that they have to cite you, I think that's an excellent case to take to mayor's court. Okay, they have the ability to do that. We had a recent situation where there's a couple. The male portion of this couple is under suspension. The female, the registration expired. There was two verbal warnings given for the registration being expired. The male was seen one day at a gas station getting out of the car. The officer walked over to him and said, look, I know you don't have driving privileges. You shouldn't be driving that car. I'm not going to go across the street and sit on you, but I don't want to see you driving. In late November, early December, they catch the person, their license or their registration still expired. They give them a ticket. Well, 3 days ago, they run the plate because that person paid for their license. But because it was over 90 days, it still expired on the person's birthday. And guess what? They didn't renew their license. So they got another ticket. This one went to mayor, or to Xenia. They had been warned. The first ticket went to mayor's court. The second ticket went to Xenia. I see those things, a lot of the speeding tickets, a lot of the crashes, a lot of the more reckless behavior. The officers usually will look at their driving record and make that determination, because if you have no real driving record and you got out and you were going a little fast one day, it's probably not that big of a deal. They tend to go to mayor's court. But if your driving record is poor or you've been warned and you're not learning, the officers believe there's a possibility of jail time, and they go to Xenia. And that is sort of the defining line as to where those tickets go.
I'm just wondering what the percentage is. It sometimes can feel like it's all of them, but I'm sure that's not the case.
Yeah. I have it. It'll be presented out of the, it may be skewed a little bit too, because there's a lot of parking tickets. They're too far from the curb, wrong way side of the street. Those are all cited under village ordinances and all go to mayor's court. So there's a large percentage that actually goes to mayor's court. When you start getting into the moving violations and the reckless violations, I would say a large percent of them go to Xenia. But usually, again, one of the things, they're driving under suspension, and especially if they've done it two or three times, they're looking at jail time. And they do not get incarcerated through mayor's court. There's no budget for it to do that. So, and I'm not opposed to doing that, but there's got to be a budget for it.
One thing I noticed, that in spite of the fact that the drug task force issue was defeated, unfortunately, but nonetheless, you guys do seem to be doing a really good job in trying to eradicate the village of a lot of this drug traffic. That's a huge concern of mine, and I for one, really appreciate that work effort. Can you give us a sense of, without the drug task force, with your individuals, how's that working for you guys?
I think most citizens on a day-to-day basis won't see a big difference.
Okay.
My concern is with drugs, there's money, and with money, and the desire to obtain money, there comes violence. You know, the, I believe there will, I mean, if coming from Huber Heights, and you're going to deliver drugs out to get to somewhere in Greene County, and you want to meet this guy from Xenia, are you going to tell him to meet you in Beaver Creek where the task force works, or meet you in Yellow Springs where the task force doesn't work? I think one of the great things we have going for us is we have a fairly good uniform presence. Because we're 1.9 miles, you know, the likelihood of them seeing a cruiser is a very big deterrent. And, you know, I don't know that I could ever say that if you stay in the task force, you're never going to have a violent drug-related crime. You can't do that. You know, the one of the concerns is, from a patrol standpoint, if I'm going out there and being proactive for drugs, I am in fact probably getting the person who is possessing and using drugs 98-99% of the time, as opposed to the task force who attempts to focus on the guys selling the drugs. Although it is illegal to use drugs and those laws have to be enforced too, I do understand that an addict needs help. Incarceration does not help an addict. I'm not even sure incarceration helps a thief. I mean, you can argue that.
It depends on what he gets when he's in there. There are treatment programs.
Absolutely.
It was announced on the news yesterday that Dayton was the worst city in the nation for drugs.
For heroin. For heroin. Yeah. Overdoses,
what's,
yes.
What's the heroin situation in the village? Is it serious?
I think much like anywhere else, there are cultures and subcultures of people who want to party and are willing to use these things. It's here. There are a large majority of people who don't seek it out, don't do that, are not influenced by it until a nephew, a grandson, a grandniece becomes involved. And I think most of us probably have that family member or family friend who knows somebody who has been affected by it. But, you know, you could live your life and never, ever see it. I mean, it's not like it is any more rampant here. I see his face, and I'm not coming up with his name. Runs TCSN, and he even said, look, it's per capita, Yellow Springs has about the same problem as Xenia or Beaver Creek or Fairborn. You know, there are a lot less people. But he's seeing pretty predominantly the same ratio per capita of it. So it is here. It, you know, there's nothing wrong with establishments that sell beer and liquor. But, you know, there is that sort of bar crowd. And if you're into that bar crowd and that partying crowd, a section of that culture is willing to step it up to the next thing, be it cocaine, be it heroin, et cetera. And it's here. I mean, it's around. You know, I believe I've had a couple people. I interviewed a girl very early on when I got here, was on a stolen car, and I asked the officer if I could go with them. Seen the jail at interview, and he got done with his interview on the stolen car, and I said, do you mind, you've been pretty honest, I'm not going to ask for names, I'm not looking to jam you up or charge you with anything, but I said, how bad's heroin in Yellow Springs? And she said, oh, it's bad. I said, I mean, you can get it anytime you wanted it? Yeah. I said, what's the youngest person you've seen use heroin? She said, 13. So, it is there. I mean, I don't say that to scare you, because again, there, you know, 90%+ of people, it's something over there, and it goes on, and does not affect the lives of people unless somebody steals, you know, something out of your car to trade for heroin. That's where you become affected by it most of the time.
Well, several years ago, how long ago was it when we had drug
use
in our neighborhood?
Like 2 years.
Was it what?
I think it was like 2 years ago.
Yeah.
Or maybe
there were a couple of people arrested.
That was the chief.
I think the chief was here.
It was prior to me coming in, there was a couple that was living together that burglarized a lot of places.
No, no, after that, though, there was someone attempting.
Okay.
And then they were found, they stole cars and stuff, and they were found to have some sort of heroin issue.
Often, well, and that's sort of always been my point, is, you know, to some degree, I don't mean to be impassionate, but if someone chooses to put something in their veins, okay. You know, I could almost argue that you should have the right to do that. But my concern as a police officer, when that person becomes an addict, and because of that addiction, steals from the neighbor, steals from someone else. There is a resident in town and allowed someone to stay with her, and I understand the situation, but I can show where that individual broke into one of her neighbors and stole the television. We have the TV. We know that he palmed the TV. He was stopped several times with heroin. And I talked to her about it, and I said, look, my concern is at some point, if he becomes desperate enough, he hurts you. And if he doesn't hurt you, that he brings someone else who uses over, who is a far more desperate, far more violent individual, and he hurts you. Because you make a really great victim. I mean, as we age and we're not as physically imposing and as agile as we used to be, we become better victims. And that is my concern.
Do your guys carry Narcan?
Yes.
I was just about to give them props for that, because
very early on,
she really pursued getting it on before.
Yes.
Drugs aside, what do we do about drunken drivers? I think it's a very serious problem. We all probably drink a little bit. That's one thing. It's another thing to get bombed and go out and drive up the wrong way in interstate and kill people. And furthermore, when you have three or four convictions against you, you're still driving.
Yes.
Now, that's entirely in my book. You throw them in jail and throw the key away. Now, justice says you can't deprive a man of getting a living wage. Well, wait a minute. How about these guys? I have no tolerance for someone that gets bombed and goes out and kills somebody. And there seems to be enough of this to be concerned about it. I don't know what you can do, because all you can do is arrest them. You go to a judge and you got some fancy lawyer that gets him off scot-free, and he's out on the street after 8 or 9 charges. Now, come on.
It is a problem. It's a problem for America. For the village itself, since I've been here, we've not had an injury crash relating to an OVI, which, you know, knock on wood, that's all good. The officers are out there. They make a lot of stops. Sometimes that, you know, people feel like they make too many stops. But they're out there. I don't want to say they're aggressively looking, but they are aware. If they see the indicators, they'll try to make the traffic stop and take the OVI. So we've charged, you know, we get 4 or 5 a month. Which may not seem like much, but when you look at the square area, that's actually a pretty good statistic. You know, the law is in place where it is stepped up. I don't know what the answer is. I really don't know long term. You know, and it's much like with drugs, you're never going to wipe the problem out. Law enforcement, I try to tell the young guys, if you think you're here being a hero and saving lives, you will be an unhappy police officer. What you have to realize is, to some degree, we're here to do our job and hopefully maintain the status quo and try to keep people as safe as possible by doing that. I mean, we may move the status quo a little bit, which I guess doesn't make it the status quo technically, but the baseline may be the better point, because no matter what we do as law enforcement, I can't stop you from having 6 beers and getting out of the way. So you're there as that deterrence. You're there as the, if you don't come home on time, then you're grounded, or you're spanked, or you're sent to your room, or you lose driving privileges. That's what law enforcement sort of represents. is the disciplinarian parental side for a lot of these people. And, you know, all we can do is maintain that line and continue it. And then to do, you know, if your officers are willing to do that, tell them all the time, you can't worry about what the prosecutors do. I'm willing to fight the prosecutors to some degree, but I'm going to lose. You know, the prosecutor says, no, this charge isn't applicable. I'm willing to argue with them up to a point. I'm not willing to, you know, cut off my nose to spite my face for it. But my job is to argue a little bit. I'm supposed to go out, you know, a little bit on the fringe and do what I can, but I'm not going to hurt myself so bad that the next time they won't listen to me at all. And you sort of have to maintain that as an officer to keep some degree of mental toughness long term, because if not, you tend to burn out a little bit.
I didn't think it was much of a problem really in Yellow Springs, but I'm thinking what the state police have to put up with.
It is amazing. You know, it's a lot of them are that third or fourth drink. You know, they're not exactly hammered, but you see the ones that are, and it's horrific. And you know, one of the things that comes with this camera of society is we see so much more of it. And the news loves to put it on. People love watching it. I'm a cop. I like watching it. But it bends our thinking, because since the inception of the automobile, I guarantee you within a couple of weeks there was somebody who drank a six-pack and got behind the wheel and drove that Model T. And that probably didn't go fast enough to hurt somebody that bad, and you didn't have all the congestion and the volume. But it's, you know, it's probably happened since the inception of the automobile.
I've heard that the police officers will give people rides home and things like that. I mean, you're not a taxi service, obviously. I think that it could also be, it's a community responsibility in a way when you see that someone has had too much to drink. And I've given rides home to people that I don't even really know that well.
Sure.
And, well, yeah, I mean, I know all of them. And people have given me rides. Or, you know, Yellow Springs is small. You can stumble home, kind of. But, you know, it's dangerous even to ride your bike when you're under the influence. You probably won't take anyone else out with you, but...
No, I push the officer, you know, and if I offend, I apologize, but we term it chicken shit in police work. Mm-hmm. I don't want that. If you're driving down the road and you're going past beaches, and here's somebody getting his keys out and he's stumbling, you don't go across the street and wait for him to get in the car. You pull in that parking lot and you tell him, sir, if you're thinking of getting behind that wheel, you're probably going to go to jail. I strongly suggest you go inside, you call a cab. If you know somebody here in town, call them. If you live close, let me pat you down and make sure you don't have a gun that I'm going to put behind my head, and I'll run you home. And we do that. You know, it's, you know, it's not all about taking people to jail. I do believe there's a point. And judges get to decide that more than cops, thank God, because I don't want the responsibility on me. But when you make the errors enough that nothing else is working, that incarceration is the appropriate route. You know, I try to let our guys know that's not a cop's decision. That's not what we do. We go out on most of these things and collect fact, collect witness statements, collect evidence, and present that. That's our job. And, you know, we're not the ones who decide that I don't like this person, and so every time I see them, they're going to go to jail. That's bad police work. That's not what we do. We should start every day with a clean slate and with as little bias as our human minds will allow us to have, and treat everybody equally and fairly. And that's what I try to push.
Chief, early on you were talking about somebody who you said he didn't want to go to jail and sat in the car for, said it 15 or 20 times. And I just want to make sure I understand. Was your position that they shouldn't have waited so long, or it's fine to wait until he calms down as opposed to shooting him? Kind of
thing? Yeah, well, it wouldn't have come to a shooting scenario, but they probably let him sit in that car longer than they should have. I would have liked to have seen him went hands-on on a soft approach. Again, you know, sir, listen, it's a temporary protection order against the person sitting here. If we don't arrest, we're in violation of a judge's order. Because it is a judge's order, we can't be in violation of it. So we have no choice. It is an arrestable mandatory arrives. You know, you've got to come to the car with us, you know, you just putting your hands on somebody is sort of that authority thing. So as he's seated, you know, number one, I'm behind him.
Yeah.
So if he's got anything in his hands or his hand moves, I'm going to see it. Number two, psychologically, I take a position of authority over this guy.
Yeah.
Sir, I know you don't want to go to jail, but we need to get you up. It's going to happen. You need to walk to my car. I'm going to put my hand on your forearm, one up underneath your arm. I'm going to help you out of the car here with me, okay?
But I'm innocent. I didn't do anything.
It's a protection order. And we have those defendants.
I'm innocent.
Oh, absolutely. And he knew he wasn't innocent. He knew the protection order was there. She wanted to drop the protection order, but hadn't yet. And she's dropped it, different story. But he's in violation of it because it's still physically there.
I have another question. Are there any black police officers in Yellow Springs now?
No, we do not have any. We tested last September. I ended up testing 36, five of which were minority. So you end up with almost that 13-16% area. Out of that test, we were hired one. And we took the top 15 scores, put them through a physical agility test, everyone passed. And then we took the top five of those and did backgrounds on them. Out of those, we actually only hired one. Two were female. One we hired, this Mr. John Whittemore, prior experience, and he was at Jamestown. And the other two were white men.
Has there been any discussion or feelings that maybe it would help in a small town like this if you had more minority police officers?
You will not have to convince me in the least. I'd love to. I will tell you, and I read an article in the Dayton Daily News a year ago, I think Dayton has spent $1.2 million trying to get more minority recruits, and it was ineffective. I don't know the answer to it. I think some of it is sort of a cultural thing. I know a lot of young black parents are telling me that they believe that anytime their child is in contact with a law enforcement officer, they're in fear of that child's life. It's going to be a very hard environment when that mentality exists to get those young men to come in. I know part of that article also dealt, they interviewed one of the guys, and he's like, you know, I sort of think about it. Man, I don't know what my friends would say. So there are police departments all over the nation understand this. We believe we need to be responsive to our community. We need to be representative of our community. They struggle to get it, but it just, there often is not the interest in the young minority community to get there.
And what about working with the schools? I mean, when kids are growing up, you know, you see them, you know their parents, you know they're part of the community. It seems like that would be a perfect place to start recruiting when they're in junior high school.
It is. You know, one of the things that you run into, and it's a well-meaning federal plan, but effectively, you have to ever accept any federal grant, which the village does, you have to be an equal employment opportunity employer. And that requires that you have a standardized test and that you take the top three, the top five, and you test them through, and you consider, even though the test scores may be 2 or 3 points different, you have to consider that as a one test score. And so when you do these things, you end up there. And if you have a black candidate in the top five, they're very happy. Providing he passes everything else, absolutely. Because I do believe it's representative of the Yellow Springs would love it. And I should be responsive to this community to the best of my ability. This time we did not get one of those candidates. I thought we had one black female, five black males, and I think a Hispanic person or two. at least two of the black males of military background, which is often, you know, because of the military and police work being sort of paramilitary, there's sort of a draw. And, you know, we will test again September when our list expires. We'll keep it active for a year. We will test again, go through the whole process again. But those are the requirements to be an equal opportunity employer. You have to go through those steps.
I'm sorry, but with all due respect, you didn't answer his basic question.
Okay, I apologize.
Why aren't you going into the local schools and talking to our students about the possibility of becoming a police officer, including the black kids in our schools? And I didn't hear you say anything about that.
I will tell you, every time I have been invited by a school to do anything, I have been there. I was at sixth grade graduation yesterday. I have spoke to the young people of color. John Gudgels invited me to two or three things. I have been there each and every time. Have I supplanted myself and went to the superintendent and said, I want to come talk to these kids about being cops? No, I have not. They did ask me to come and speak before a prom about OBIs and the danger of OBIs. I did that. And maybe it's me. Maybe I should be more aggressive in this area, but it seems to me it is the schools. The schools want me in. I'll come in and talk about anything. I've been in churches and spoke. Early on, when the Black Lives Matter group was coming in, you know, I was the only speaker who sort of had an opposing viewpoint. I was there. I was here 6 weeks, 8 weeks. Took a little bit of something. My village manager was like, are you sure you want to do this? And I'm like, you know, it's an opinion. I'm going to issue an opinion. I hopefully will be there. I'm happy to do it. I just don't know that it's my role to interject myself into the schools. I'm willing to do it.
Have you been disinvited?
Not that I'm aware of.
You know what, Bruce, I would say...
Let me finish.
All right, I thought there was a question.
When Jim McKee, your longtime predecessor, mm-hmm. was police chief, he would make it a weekly habit to go into each school in the system, walk the hallways, walk into classrooms. The teachers would always introduce him and who he was. Okay. And he would get an opportunity to talk to both white kids and black kids about becoming police officers. And I don't get the sense that that's what you're doing. I don't think that you would be disinvited. I think that they would more than invite your presence in their school buildings to talk to their students about police work, about becoming police officers, and so on. But I don't hear you saying anything about doing that.
I will tell you, I spoke to Mr. Cryer, Mr. Hausch, and Mr. Besoro, and said, anytime you need something from me, you want me there, you let me know. Again, have I been aggressive enough to implant myself? No. And maybe I should consider that. I have not been a police chief before. This is sort of new territory for me. I will consider the idea. On a personal, I'm probably not that brash, but I'm not opposed to doing it. You know, it seems to me, and Pastor Randolph's invited me to the church. I've taken those opportunities. Much like I said, what do you want me to speak about? And I sort of give them that. And maybe historically it's been that way. You may be right, and maybe I need to be better at it.
Maybe what is needed is, I think, more than this sort of presence, because I don't think that's enough, not just in this case, but in all cases, similar communities. I think maybe if somehow we could work with the school system in terms of working out some type of program, and I'm not in a position to say what that program should be, but something that does more
to just talk about, I would try to recruit, but somehow establishing a program that sort of emphasizes the necessity, the opportunities, et cetera. And that's something that not specifically, but in general, I don't think it's being done. And I think that that would go a long ways towards helping to solve this problem.
I think the point that these guys, the point that these guys tried to make is that there was a report, an incredibly good, wonderful report, between the whole police department and the village, and especially the kids growing up. And what they're wondering is, could you be involved? Could you see the future, the need, the advantage of such an approach, and actually do it?
Yes. And I guess here's one of my things. One of the issues I came when I came here, I had, out of my 10 full-time officers, me being one of them, five of them had less than a year on. One of the things is it is not the world when Chief McKee was here. You could take that guy, that high school guy, and go, you know, you're doing a good job. Why don't you come be a cop? When I spoke to the high school kids before prom, and one of the things I did is I had all sorts of job titles and average salaries. And we went over, okay, this is what you're going to pay for housing, and this is what you're going to pay for groceries. And they had sheets of paper. They were making $85,000. They had 8.5 sheets of paper. So I cut off this much for housing, et cetera. And then I said, what's an OBI going to cost you? Because it's about $10,000. And I cut that off, and they went, oh. But one of the things I asked, I said, anybody here want to be a cop or a fireman? I got zero response, which doesn't mean that there wasn't anybody there. I am willing to do this, and again, maybe I need to be better at it. I've been very open with Mr. Gudgell. I'm willing to come in. I'm willing to talk.
Well, I think the difference between what these guys have been saying and what you're saying is the difference between doing it and being willing to do it.
I'm not quite sure you that's what I was trying to get at. Yeah. It's not just a matter of saying something and talking about it. I was talking about establishing some type of program, which is quite different from what's been said.
Let me just say this one point.
Jim McKee did not have a program.
I know, but this, but what's not, what
he, that's not 40 years ago.
But he visited the school and walked the hallways and would drop into the classrooms and talk to the kids, not necessarily about being police officers, but many of them became police officers because he talked to them.
I'm going to jump in here. Thank you for those comments, and I do understand what you're saying. We live in a different world.
And I understand.
And I really, really do respect what you're saying. Chief, what I'm wondering is, in terms of program intervention, I understand that recently you and a number of the other council members and Patty worked with the third grade teachers to bring in more understanding of how the village works. That might be one avenue that you could continue to expand on. That, I think, is what we're saying. Is that correct?
Yes. It's a different world, too. Like, I have three children at Mills Lawn right now, and the feeling that I have had from a lot of the parents is they don't want that. Like, it's a negative feeling towards police, it's a negative feeling towards military, of which my husband is one. They don't want that.
Because they see the police officers in today's world as a negative.
Right.
And I think what we're attempting to do is to change that perspective of police officers. The reality is that none of us want military procedures in our lines. If a crime takes place, that's exactly what you want. You want somebody that's in there, trained, they know how to disarm that person that is about to hurt you. So there is sort of a double-edged sword with all of this. And I fully respect that Yellow Springs has a culture where we like to get along, we like to be tolerant, we like to be respectful of one another. We also need to be safe. We also need to live in an environment that we are now able to leave our doors open. We'd never do that now. When I was growing up, of course, that's what we did. We'd go into each other's houses and outside playing and we'd get ice water. You'd never do that now. And I don't see that we are ever really going to go back to that. I'd like to, but it's not going to happen. And we need to adjust our world. I'm sorry?
That's not the way the world works.
It just isn't. I really, really wish it were, but it isn't.
I know.
It isn't. And I mean, I respect what you're saying, and I think Dad did have that concept of community policing. Mm-hmm. There are portions of that concept that would work beautifully in our community, and I think we need to expand on them. But there's also a different world, a different lifestyle, a different approach that I think we need to incorporate in that. It's not throw the baby out of the wash and get everything that he did out. I don't say that at all. I'm simply saying that we live in a different world and we have to adjust to that world.
What I heard here is not challenging you or pointing at you or whatever. It's sort of like...
Or accusing.
Just long-term concern about the flavor and atmosphere.
Right. And I think she articulated between her and Kate a little bit. I don't always get the impression that they want us there. That if you get a police officer walking through the school, kids are texting home going, what's the problem and are we shutting down? Is there a man walking through with a rifle? That is always the concern. I am up at the elementary school at least once a week in the morning greeting the kids. I have other officers that do that. When Ms. Morgan's class did that, I believe I was the first one to respond. I went in to be interviewed. The Bulldog News asked me to be there. Sure, what morning do you need me to be there? And again, maybe I should take a more aggressive approach. I did not grow up in this community. I was not a police officer for 4 or 5 years before becoming chief. I'm still trying to get faces and names. Chief McKee had some advantages over me. And so, yeah, I don't have 100% of the vibe here. Will not argue that. But I will say again, I've been available whenever anybody's asked. I've not overly interjected myself because, as Kate has indicated, I'm not sure they want me interjecting myself. But I think I've denied one invitation. Now, I can't remember what it was, but the wife and I were going out of town or as a kid's birthday or something. I've not said no to anybody. My hours is flexible. And again, as sort of that CEO, I'm the figurehead. I'm going to be there with it all possible, even when sometimes the questions are tough. And everybody may like my answers, but I at least hope people would go, at least Chief Hale told me what he thought and was forthright and honest. If I can walk away from this eventually with that, people say that about me, I'm relatively happy. If I don't fit in long term here, again, that is for the village to decide. I'm not hurt by that. I mean, I surely I would be hurt by it, but I'm not going to be personally damaged by it.
I don't think anyone is saying that you were in the wrong place.
Well, 4th of July, I put on Darth Vader costume. I passed out candy. Pictures of it. When I was going through the problem, we went it on Facebook. There's a Facebook page of me doing that. I'm in a cruiser with a lightsaber, took tons of pictures with kids, passed out candy, did this thing. So I believe I am doing some of those things, but again, I don't think I'm interjecting myself into somewhere that I'm not asked. And as Kate indicated, I don't know that I've got the vibe in front of people that that's really what they want me to do, even though that may have worked in the past.
Well, I would say from working with the kids, mostly in the high school and some in the grade school, and also the students are wondering why the police are in schools all the time. Mm-hmm. I don't think they're in the schools as much as they think, but they feel like they are, and then they tell their parents, well, many of whom feel like the police are evil anyway, and that's just more proof that you're a son of a bitch.
When the officers did that feedback, I mean, I've been doing this 32 years. My skin's pretty tough anymore. I understand and see the bigger picture. When you're 26 and you've been doing it for 2 or 3 years, you can just do some of those things I just don't think exist. And some of it, no offense to any attorneys in the room, but we became a very, very litigious society where we want all of this. Part of the downfall of all the cameras is it takes away officers' discretion. Used to, again, it was well, you know, Jim, yeah, you had too many to drink, I'm taking you home. Now with Mothers Against Drunk Drivers, they are pushing for policies and state laws that you have to arrest somebody in order that takes that discretion away from the officer. You know, with the flip side of that, and again, you know, I was pretty young, but there was a lot of times that, you know, people probably should have went to jail for spousal abuse or overly disciplining a child, as beating a child as opposed to disciplining a child. That didn't happen back then because it was the 60s, it was the 70s, and you got by with a lot of things. It was what was expected, it was the norm. And that era is gone, and with that, police work has changed, and the perception of police work by society has changed, and you know, and the officers feel it. And so, you know, I think you have some very salient points, but again, as if you hear what Kate says, when the officers get that feedback from some of these people, yeah, they're not real energetic about going out. We did a bike radio a couple weeks ago. The officers are sure, but we'll come in. We're happy to do that. Once or twice I fixed, somebody's been at the Bryan Center, their bikes, they've got the tools out, fixed their bikes. I mean, to me it's the little things, and if I can keep officers, you know, I talked about having officers only in for 5 years, I believe that if you can get the department structured well enough, you know, you can make the officers happy. If we keep them long-term longer, they're going to be more in tune to the village, whether they live here or not. When an officer comes through for a year or two, is going somewhere else, we're not going to have that. You get that by getting people, keeping people, and as they grow up and get a little older, you know, we become a little more tender with age. And that's what the village sort of wants. I'd love to keep those people, and I'm doing everything that I believe I can to do that, to help that effort. So.
I think John Gudgell is a great influence and a great mentor in the schools. And I'm wondering if there's some way that you and he could have a conversation and maybe he can help without having the police in the school, but have John in some way or another introduce the idea of a program that would help.
I saw John at graduation last night. I talked to John fairly often. Again, my thing has always been, and Don can tell you, he came out, I'm like, sure, when you want me? And he's like, I got 3 dates. I said, he says, I got 3 dates. I said, I'll make it easy. I'll take the earliest one.
Yeah.
You know, I'll take you off the hook because you still got, these other people may not have it.
Yeah.
I believe, you know, because I am not out here making arrests and writing tickets, this is my job. Coming here and talking to you is my job. Being the cheerleader for the department is my job, and I try to make myself as available as I can in that to explain it. I push people, anyone, come in and talk to me. Kate came to my office and talked for 2 hours. Mm-hmm. We had a 10-minute conversation and talked for 2 hours. You know, my door should not be shut, and you may not understand it, and Kate and I may not always see eye to eye on things, but I'll try to explain why I feel the way I feel. As long as you're not throwing things at me, I'll sit and talk to you for quite a while. So that's the other thing I try to do is be as open as possible.
He's a person that you could go to that might help with
facilitate that.
Yeah, I really do.
I've been here 50 years, and I have never been to a meeting that the majority of the people in the audience didn't feel that they knew better than the person that was presenting it. I hope you're not offended. By that, because the suggestions here versus all these experts that think they know more, I want to thank you for making me feel very safe and secure in this village. And I felt that way for the last 50 years. I don't see a change. I hope to God it doesn't change with the booting out of the drug force. Any place that boots out a drug force at the time that 15 miles from here is the heaviest used drug thing.
There's a lot of really very good things. But I think when you start getting in your 50s and if you're used to living in suburbia, moving to a farm is probably a bad idea. And if you're used to living in a farm, moving to suburbia is probably a bad idea. And if you're living in a village and you've been in this community and you're getting in your 50s and 60s, change is not something you want. And I do believe there's a difference between being dedicated to a community and living in that community. And I do understand the desire to have me here. I'll say there's a flip side of that coin, and that is, you know, I've had to do a couple sort of controversial things already in the year and a half, 2 years I've been here. I don't relish the idea of going to Tom's Market to get a gallon of milk and have to defend myself on those issues.
Yeah.
And there is a bit of autonomy of not living here that allows me to do certain things that I may be slightly intimidated to do if I in fact lived here, because I know what some of those consequences would be, but there is some baggage that comes with that. And again, I'm not saying that one is good and one is bad, but whenever there's a coin, there's always the two sides to it, so.
Well, you're living in an enchanted village. It's a hell of a sight different than living in a big city. And so the people here are spoiled. And then they don't understand what the police have to go through in a city like New York City, San Francisco, and Chicago.
It's a different world. Yes, it is.
Absolutely. So I think when people say, well, you got to make the world like it is in Yellow Springs, they're crazy as hell.
Well, I would tell you, and the wife and I have discussed it. I have a son who just graduated second lieutenant Army. He'll be going to Fort Campbell. I have a daughter who will technically graduate and wants to go to med school. So we'll see where they go. But we've talked about retirement. I love the idea of retiring here. I'm not real sure I want to live here as the chief of police. But I love the idea of retiring here. I love the idea that I can walk or ride my bike and get 97% of everything I need. That if I decide to have that third beer and shouldn't get behind the wheel, I can stumble home. Because I do like my beer. And so there's a lot of really, really neat things that I wish my mother-in-law would have moved here 18 years ago. We don't have a speed limit of 35 miles an hour. When you're 86 as she is, she'll still get along pretty good here. The highway scares me when she gets on it. So there, trust me, I understand some of the benefits. And I'm not opposed to necessarily living in the town, but again, I think there's benefits and detriments to it, depending on what happens. When everything's rosy, oh, it's great.
Thank you, Chief. You really have spent a lot of time. Thank you.